Children's Hall for the Performing Arts. Previn and the Pittsburgh. With Andre Previn and the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see, at the moment, I'm sitting in Heinz Hall, the home of the Pittsburgh Symphony. But, as you can also see, the stage is dark and empty of musicians. And the reason for this is that for tonight's program, we're going back to a studio in London, where a few months ago, I had the pleasure of talking to and about Stephen Sondheim. A review of Stephen's work called Side by Side by Sondheim has been packing a theater there for the last year. And the three stars of the show, Millicent Martin, David Kernan, and Julia McKenzie, joined us in that studio to sing some of his songs. Now, before you actually meet Mr. Sondheim, let me use this opportunity of saying a few things about him that would probably embarrass him if I were to say them to his face. The American musical theater is an art form of which this country can and should be very proud. Oh, certainly, musicals have been written in many other countries, but when it comes right down to it, the musical is very much an American domain. The Broadway stages have been lit up with countless glittering successes and with well-meaning failures ever since the production of The Black Crook started the whole genre in 1866. However, the true innovators in this field have been fairly small in number. Just to name a few, Rodgers and Hart with Pal Joey made it clear that the anti-hero had a place on the musical stage. Cole Porter proved that worldliness and sophistication had a place in it, and Rodgers and Hammerstein's Oklahoma opened a great many doors. I suppose it should be said that the zenith, the culmination of that older style of musical, was exemplified by Lerner and Lowe's My Fair Lady. And now there's Stephen Sondheim. He first made his mark as a lyricist only, with two smash hits, West Side Story, with music by Leonard Bernstein, and Gypsy, music by Julie Stein.
Well, I was supposed to do the music for Gypsy, but Ethel Merman didn't want to take a chance on an unknown, so I went ahead and did it anyway because I thought it would be instructive to write for a star and learn something about that, and also because I loved the notion of the piece, Arthur Lawrence's idea for the book.
If you had considered yourself principally a composer, mm-hmm. when Lenny asked you to write lyrics, did you resist it?
Oscar Hammerstein was sort of my mentor, and he said, look, first of all, these men will teach you a lot about the theater, meaning Robbins and Lawrence and Bernstein, because they were all established and all experienced, and he thought I should learn from somebody else besides him. And he said, secondly, are you interested in the subject? And I said, sort of. He said, that's enough. Go ahead and write it. And he was right.
Now, how long did you have to wait before somebody said, no, do the whole thing?
Well, actually, nobody said that. What happened was that after West Side opened, I started to feel slightly professional, so I went to Bert Shevelov, who was a friend, and said, how would you like to write a musical? Because I knew I knew him to be a first-rate lyric writer and a good librettist, and he had the idea of taking some of Plautus's plays and making them into a musical, and then he got Larry Gelbart, and they co-wrote it, and I did the score, and it was just assumed that we would do it together. In the meantime, Gypsy came along, and it was an offer to do music again, and as I say, I was turned down on that, but I went ahead and did the lyrics anyhow. Then I did Forum, and that was the first time I had music on Broadway.
Was, despite the brilliance of its lyrics, still fairly standard in terms of composing. But his second show, Anyone Can Whistle, was a giant step forward in the evolution of the musical, despite the fact that it was deemed a failure by the critics. Since that day, 13 years ago, Stephen's progress has been steady and spectacular, and he is now unquestionably the best and most important composer-lyricist living. Oblivious to the kind of success that would turn almost anyone else's head, he has pursued his craft with total devotion. It's fascinating to me as a musician to trace the growth of his output. His lyrics are more and more poetic in nature, a statement which he will no doubt dispute with vehemence, and his music is about as far away from the innocent 32-bar pop song structure as it is possible to imagine. His last show, Pacific Overtures, was closer to opera than any musical has ever dared to be. And it wouldn't surprise me for a split second if, within the foreseeable future, his as yet unwritten works were to be moved from the Broadway Theater to the stages of the opera houses of the world.
It has been said by such learned people as critics that you actually are heading toward writing an opera, and you very often write a huge kind of Puccini line anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So is that something that you have an ambition for?
Well, what happened was I got interested around the time of Anyone Can Whistle in writing songs, song forms that involved traditional operatic forms, duets, trios, moderately, for at least for Broadway, complicated choral pieces. By the time I got to Company and Follies, I was hooked on trying those different things.
Which you do, by the way, forgive me, not in the accustomed by now Broadway tradition of you have a line, I have a line, you ask a question, I give the answer, but you split up a syllable at a time sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah, because I love playing around with it. And also, you see, I like so much the sense of conversation between people. There's a song, as a matter of fact, in Company I'll get to in a minute. But I don't like to think of myself as an opera composer or going towards opera. But I do want to get into more and more singing in proportion to the speech. But I don't want to lose the conversational quality. I want the lyrics to also have interest. Now, there are many critics and people who write on music who say you can't do that, that it is a paradox. That is to say, if music is to carry the evening, then giving prominence to the lyrics is going to undercut the music and is ruining the purpose. I don't think that's true. I don't see any reason why a compromise can't be made. And by compromise, I do not mean a giving up of something, but utilizing vocal techniques to make lyrics come out, to make lyric points. To go back to this number called Barcelona in Company, there's a situation I suppose I should set up for anybody who doesn't know the song or doesn't know Company, which is that the hero, Bobby, who's a confirmed bachelor and who has a lot of girlfriends, meets an airline hostess whose name is April, and he takes her back to his flat. And after spending the night together, she has to get up very early in the morning. The alarm goes off, and he wakes sleepily and finds her putting on her airline stewardess's uniform. And Bobby and April sing this duet.
Look, you're a very special girl, not just overnight. No, you're a very special girl, and all because you're bright. Not just because you're bright, you're just a very special girl. What you thinking?
Barcelona.
Oh.
Flight 18.
Stay a minute.
I would like to.
So?
Don't be mean.
Oh, stay a minute.
No, I can't.
Yes, you can.
No, I can't.
Where you going?
Barcelona.
So you said.
Madrid.
Bon voyage.
On a boring.
Good night.
You're angry.
No.
I've got to
write,
report to,
go,
and that to say that if I had my way, oh well, I guess, okay.
What?
I'll stay.
But...
This is the other kind of duet I'm talking about. This is Too Many Mornings from Follies, which is a show about a group of showgirls who haven't seen each other for 25 years, get back together, and all their old hates, loves, etc., etc., are resuscitated. This is a duet between a lady who's been obsessed with a guy who jilted her 25 years ago. She's an ex-showgirl, and she's been living in the Midwest, and he's now very glamorous, and they see each other for the first time, and he, because he's having an unhappy marriage, fools himself into thinking that seeing her has revived the old love. So they sing this duet in which they are essentially fooling themselves, but in which they are declaring their passion for each other. And this comes under your sort of Puccini heading.
Too many mornings, waking and pretending I reach for you. Thousands of mornings dreaming of my girl. All that time wasted merely passing through. Time I could have spent so content wasting time with you. Wishing that the room might be filled with you. Morning to morning, turning into days. All the days that I thought would never end. All the nights with another day to spend. Sally resting in my arms, with her head against my head. Time, but it's time enough for me.
of my favorite words, which is misused a lot, is pastiche. I have to tell you just peripherally that I was in New York recently, and I went to see Tom Stoppard's Travesties. And on the way out, somebody very disgruntled, it's absolutely true, said, "I don't see what's so terrific about that play. It's just a pistache."
Yes, right.
Terrific.
Right.
That also, you can take that word apart and make endless meanings. But you do use that, especially in Follies.
Yeah, well, actually, I started using it in Anyone Can Whistle. I thought the heartlessness of traditional American musical comedy, the heartlessness of the song forms, you know, that they were all one color and they were hard-edged or whatever, could be used to say something else. So that the character, the venal mayoress, played by Angela Lansbury in Anyone Can Whistle, who was always very gay and giddy, but who had her eye on the quick buck and on taking advantage of everybody, her entire language, musical language in the show, was traditional nightclub song forms, nightclub via Cole Porter. Hip, sometimes via Kay Thompson, to go back to your old days at MGM, with lots of hand clapping and lots of very rich Hugh Martin harmonies. And but what she was singing about was how, in one song, how the entire town was economically ruined. But she sang it in a very up Williams Brothers, Kay Thompson, finger-snapping style, which told the audience that she was concerned about her town, but she was more concerned about herself.
Yes.
It was not, "Oh, my poor town." It was, "Oh, my poor town." It was that kind of thing. All her songs for that character, everybody else sang what I would call straight, meaning whatever the emotion was. She always sang in a traditional form. And I liked that so much, I went on to develop it in Follies, in which all four central characters, two men and two women, have a kind of, this is not a musical pun, fugue, meaning psychological fugue at the end, in which they all fall back into the past and express what's going on in the turbulence of their own emotions at this point in their lives through Follies' songs, Follies' kinds of songs. Millie Martin is going to sing a song called Uptown Downtown, which was cut out of Follies in Boston and replaced by another one. And went into a dance number, so it's quite a short song. But it's a woman who's very rich, who was once the showgirl, and somehow misses, and she knows she does, the freedom and the friendliness of the life when she was just a chorus girl with all the other kids in the cast. And now she's New York's wealthiest, or one of her wealthiest, and leading hostess in New York, and married to a man who works at the UN, and she likes that too because she always wanted to be rich. And so she sings a Follies type song about a split personality.
Now this is the tale of a dame known as Harriet, who climbed to the top of the heap from the bottom. A beautiful life was her claim, and to vary it, she wanted the sun and the moon, and she got 'em. She isn't the least exhausted from her climb, but she does look back from time to time. And the subject of this evening's quiz is who she was and who she Harriet, the Nouveau from New Rochelle. She sits in the Ritz with her splits of mums, her stars divine, for a Stein with her village chums, but with a Schlitz in her midst down in Fitzroy's bar. She thinks of the Ritz, oh, it's so schizo. Should she be uptown?
in your terminology, makes what constitutes the point during a play that a song becomes necessary?
Well, Oscar's principle was that when the emotions bubble up to the surface and seem to be too passionate for speech, that's when you should come into song. There are many other ways to write songs. One of the hardest score I've ever had to write was Forum, because it is a farce and there is no emotion as such, and the songs must act as respites. And it was Bert Shevelov who pointed out to me that there are many, many different ways to approach songs. I've been brought up by Oscar, who said, write amid emotional peaks. But what about when you have an unemotional show? And as Bert pointed out, he said, Cole Porter wrote individual songs, and you admire those, so why can't... And I said, I see the point. And in fact, the songs in Roman comedies were used as rest periods for the audience. And I got very despairing while we were writing for him, because I said to Bert, why don't you just play this as a farce? It's a wonderful farce. What do you need the songs for? And he said, it'll be too relentless. You have to give the audience a rest. So I was there to let everybody relax. And at first I resented it, and then I realized he was dead right.
No, but that constitutes a real... I have a long sentence. Go ahead and light that, if you would.
No, I have to find a light out with it. Don't worry about it.
No, but I mean, you see, I have to say something that borders on total heresy, and that is... I adored the musical My Fair Lady, but in fact, I like Pygmalion better, because although the songs are sensational, I don't find them necessary.
I feel exactly the same way. That is maybe the best musical I ever saw from the point of view of entertainment, and I still prefer Pygmalion. I prefer the movie, or I did prefer the movie till I saw it a second time, to the play. Yes, that is a case where Alan Lerner and Fritz Lowe got excited by the notion. For them, it enhances it. For you and me, it didn't, even though it's a marvelous show.
Oh, it is. Yeah.
But for them, it excited them enough to write it. No, if you said to me, how would you like to do Pygmalion as a musical, I'd say, gee, I don't see that we can better it, or that we can do anything that will add a color to it that isn't right there in the play. For them, it did. They had a vision that you and I don't have. It's all a matter of choice. You know, Rodgers and Hammerstein wanted to do Pygmalion.
Yeah.
Oscar saw something in it, and I would love to have heard their version as contrasted to Lerner and Lowe's. Would love to have those playing side by side and see what the difference, because it would have been very educational to see how two men have one vision of a show and two have another.
Many lyricists and writers or whatever have favorite subjects, whether it's unrequited love or vengeance or whatever. It seems to me you have a great leaning toward people who are ambivalent about their emotions.
Oh, yes. It's my favorite thing to write about because, A, it's the way I feel, and I think it's the way most people feel, and it wasn't dealt with very much on the musical stage. People had an emotion and sang about it, and certainly the Rodgers and Hammerstein tradition, although the soliloquy from Carousel is a study in ambivalence. I mean, you know, I'm hardly the first. But it's something I also find pertinent in urban living, and I'm a New Yorker born, bred, and rooted. And it's also, I suppose, a reflection of my own life. But I find it universal enough to write about all the time. And ambivalent feelings, well, I like to do them sometimes straight on. That is to say, you utilize a lyric. We'll hear Sorry Grateful in a minute, which is about that. But sometimes it's about singing one thing and having the music express something else. So the song on top is very smooth and music is very angry, for example. It allows for dramatic contrast, and I think it's really about that old devil subtext, which is talked about all the time in the theater these days, particularly since the growth of the Actor's Studio.
Forgive me, but explain that just a little.
It's that while I'm talking to you right now, I'm thinking I want to kill you. That subtext. If I'm playing the scene, then I must keep that in mind. That gives the scene much more interest than if I just talk. Mm-hmm. On the stage, you want to have the feeling, and the best actors always find a subtext, something that leaves the audience something to discover or smell, or it gives body. It gives body. It's like body in wine. It's something underneath,
which
something
you then must
around.
Explain to the actor after you write the song.
Right. Sure, or he will get it, or sometimes even invent, although I always have very specific subtexts in mind. But no, most actors bring their own subtext with them. If the author is a good author and can give them that, it lets them do it, of course. But so almost all the songs in Company that Bobby sings, I mean, he's somebody who supposedly is happy with his unmarried life. And what we have to discover without being told is that underneath he's screaming. And I've done things musically in that show to illustrate that, to demonstrate that. But there's a song in Company that I put in early for the very purpose of telling the audience that this was going, because the whole show is about marriage. And by marriage, I do not necessarily mean marriage contracts. I mean one-to-one relationships. And there's a song in which Bobby says to one of his, all his friends are married couples, he says to one of the husbands, Harry, are you ever sorry you got married?
You're always sorry. You're always grateful. You're always wondering what might have been. Then she walks in and still you're sorry and still you're grateful and still you wonder and still you doubt. Then she goes out. Everything's different, nothing's changed, only maybe slightly rearranged. You're sorry, grateful, regretful, happy. Why look for answers when none occur? You always are. What you always were, which has nothing to do, all to do with her. You're always sorry, you're always grateful, you hold her thinking, I'm not alone. You're still alone. You don't live for her. You do live with her. You're scared she's starting to drift away. And scared she'll stay. Good things get better. Get worse. Wait, I think I meant that in reverse. You're sorry, grateful, regretful, happy. Why look for answers when none occur? You'll always be what you always were. Which has nothing to do with, all to do with her. You'll always be what you always were, which has nothing to do with, all to do.
Your songs are almost never, I found out never is a dangerous word, but almost never the standard AB or 32 bars or whatever you want to call it. Your words are never common words, and the structure has meter changes, tempo changes, whatever. You don't care for rhymes the way they are commonly done in pop songs. Did you ever think of writing a piece of prose and setting it?
I'm very bad at prose writing, which I do not say with any false modesty. I tend to be verbose. One of the things I like about writing lyrics is they restrict me from getting too verbal, from using too many words. I have a handbook that I recommend to anybody who wants to write. It's a tiny little book written by E.B. White. And
Elements
the Elements of Style,
sure.
And it tells you everything you need to know about really what words are for. It's about simplicity. I find it very useful and easy to put those principles in operation when I'm writing lyrics. When I come to write prose, even a letter, it just tumbles all over the place. So I don't think I could ever set prose. Now, I like to write wordy lyrics in the sense that I like a lot of words to the phrase. There's a verse for a song in Anyone Can Whistle called The Wimpy Trumpets that Millie Martin's going to sing, which has a lot of words, but it expresses a kind of anger. But then the music and the words clear, and it gets very, very simple. It also illustrates something we were talking about earlier, which is my fondness for Vamps, because this is a song in which it starts with a very heavy running figure, and then when it clears, the music is very sparse, and then the vamp starts to come in, and the accompaniment starts to get heavier and heavier. And of course, that's an old musical comedy tradition, you know, play the chorus higher and faster, and then eventually you get the cakewalk chorus that slows down the 2/4, and it always gets a hand.
You smug little man with your smug little schemes, you forgot one thing. The rest of the world is no like you. There are heroes in the world, princes and heroes in the world, and one of them will save us. Wait and see. Wait and see. There won't be trumpets or bolts of fire to say he's coming. No Roman candles, no angels' choir, no sound of distant drumming. He may not be the cavalier, tall and graceful, fair and strong. Doesn't matter, just as long as he comes along. But not with trumpets or lightning flashing or shining armor. Maybe he's a farmer. He can wait. What's another day? He has lots of hills to climb. And a hero doesn't come till a nick of time. Don't look for trumpets or whistles to link. There won't be trumpets, but sure as shooting, you'll know him when you see him. Don't know when, don't know where, and I can't even say that I care. All I know is the minute you turn and he's suddenly there.
Do you ever look at songs that you wrote many years ago that were eminently successful, that worked, and have a desperate feeling that you would like to rewrite a line now?
Oh, sure. Most of West Side Story I would like to rewrite now. It was very young work, and I was persuaded to try to be poetic, which is my least favorite kind of lyric. That is, when you say,
beautiful morning.
Ah, no, that is real poetry because it's so simple. No, I'm saying, tonight the world was just an address. I mean, I shiver when I say it. That's the second chorus of tonight. The show is full of lines like that because Lenny really wanted the show to have size and substance. And what I finally realized, and I learned it very much from Oscar, but mostly through that show, was when you write, I just kissed a girl named Maria, that's poetry because of how it sits on the music. Lyrics don't exist by themselves. It's what happens when they're with the music. Oh, what a beautiful morning is a line I'd be ashamed to put on paper. But once you hear it with Rogers' melodic line, it's...
Couldn't be better.
That's known as poetic. That's genuinely poetic.
Did you ever write poetry?
I wrote a tiny amount of poetry in college, and I realized I wasn't a poet. And I didn't want to be a poet a lot. I just thought it would be fun, and I only experimented with traditional forms because I love puzzles, and the idea of writing a sonnet was nirvana to me.
You write puzzles, which is even weirder.
Well, yes, right. I'm a big fan of the listener puzzles. I've been subscribing to the listener for 20 years. And I did a series of puzzles for New York Magazine. They were the first British puzzles done in the United States of that tricky a nature. There is one other cryptic puzzle that had existed before in the nation. But all the puzzle doers in the United States do straightforward.
I'll tell you how I admire that, because I do like words, and I read a lot and all that. When it comes to doing puzzles or playing Scrabble, I will look at the puzzle for like 20 minutes and then put down he.
Really?
Dog.
I'm surprised
Total brick wall.
It's a curious and perverted ability to be able to see a word as a collection of letters instead of as having a meaning or a sound. For example, you love puns. Mm. So obviously the sound of words is something you're very into, and you're very quick and good at puns. And of course the precision of your language. You just don't see words as collections of letters. I passed under, when Cinerama first was invented, I passed under the sign that was being erected on Broadway. It said Cinerama, and I immediately thought, American. Didn't have to think about
it. Wait a minute, Cinerama.
And American are anagrams of each other. And I just looked at it, just went click, because I have the kind of mind, as anybody who does the listener puzzle does, to see it as letters, not as having any sense at all.
If somebody had said to me, there is an anagram in Cinerama, second hint, it's a country. I would have said Yugoslavia, right?
Right,
you know, impossible. Okay, let's get back to poetry for a minute. It seems to me that one of the obvious problems in lyric writing is the fact that if you read poetry, you can read it, you can take all the time you want reading it, so that if you have a poet who's slightly difficult to understand, you can kind of learn the poem as you go, at your own tempo, as it were. And a lyric comes at you once.
Well, you've just hit the whole secret of all lyric writing, and what distinguishes lyrics from poetry is that they exist in time. The audience, which is an ear, only gets one chance to hear it. Not only do they only get one chance to hear it, but they're also looking at somebody, looking at costumes, scenery, paying attention to the scene, and hearing music, which is the richest form of art that I know. And so they're assaulted, and therefore lyrics always must be underwritten. But the real point is to make it easy for the audience to understand what you're saying. And that is the trick of lyric writing, and that's why some of the simplest and most spontaneous lyrics have taken the longest time. Simply to make clear to the audience what is happening. Now, there are techniques within that that you can use to point up things to the ear. For example, rhyme. Most people who write lyrics don't understand why rhymes occur. They just rhyme at the end of lines to kind of neaten it out, like tying up the package, without giving proper thought to the fact that a rhyme gives a point to a word. If you don't want that word pointed up, do not rhyme it. And if you do want it, one way to point it up is to rhyme. Another way is to put it on the downbeat. Another way is to make an appoggiatura out of it. Another way, etc. There are many techniques to point up a word. But rhymes often will get in the way of sense. And not enough attention is paid to that. In fact, one of the problems I find in lyric writing is quite often the thought will give you two words that don't rhyme but have a close vowel sound. Like you may end up with home and alone, and you can't use it because it sounds as if you tried to rhyme it.
Yeah, right.
And the result is so you try to find home and paste, something that is so far away that the ear knows that that is not what's meant. Inner rhymes have another function.
Well, that's Cole Porter's big...
Oh, well, that's it. What inner rhymes do is they speed up a line and they give what might be an ordinary line brilliance. It's like high gloss. It's like a polish. But they also tend to give motion to a line. I love the lyric, Where's the Life That Led I Led from Kiss Me, Kate, because the inner rhymes help the line speed up, and perfectly okay jokes like she gave a new meaning to the Leaning Tower of Pisa is suddenly a hilarious joke because of the rhyme of meaning and leaning. If you take that rhyme out, the joke has lost half of its sheen and is half as funny. That's something he understood and is impeccable on.
Our Love Affair Was Too Hot
Not to Cool Down. Exactly. It gives a punch to a line that's a perfectly nice line, but is a brilliant line because of that rhyme.
But you're very conscious of small words.
Oh, yes, I am indeed. A song in Little Night Music, which Julie's going to sing, as a matter of fact, called The Miller's Son, pays great attention to small words. There's a refrain that keeps going, which says, we'll go dancing, and ends up by saying, we'll have dancing. And the use of the word have is precisely what the point is. Also, the song is full of rhymes, and often rhymes will imply education on the part of the singer because it's a kind of crisp, literate way. Well, this is a supposedly uneducated girl, a maid, who is singing about her view of sex and life, as opposed to all the sophisticates on the stage who are dallying with each other and waving fans and winking. And she's talking about you have to grab what you can while you can. And I found that by using the rhymes, far from making it literate, at least in my opinion, what it did was give it great excitement and inner speed.
I shall marry the miller's son. Pin my hat on a nice piece of property. Friday nights for a bit of fun. We'll go dancing. It's a wink and a wiggle and a giggle on the grass, and I'll strip the life and dangle a pinch and a diddle in the middle of what passes by. It's a very short road from the pinch and the punch to the paunch and the pouch and the pension. It's a very short road to the 10,000 lunch and the belch and the grouch and the sigh. In the meanwhile, there are mouths to be kissed before mouths to be fed, and a lot in between in the meanwhile. Businessman, five fat babies and lots of security. Friday nights, if we think we can, we'll go dancing. It's a push and a fumble and a tumble in the sheets and a foot in the high look fancy. A dip in the butter and a flutter with what meets my eye. It's a very short fetch from the push and the whoop to the squint and the stoop and the mumble. It's not much of a stretch to the crimp and the froop and the bosoms that droop and go dry. In the meanwhile, there are mouths to be kissed before mouths to be fed. And there's many a tryst and there's many a bed to be sampled. The Prince of Wales, pearls and servants, and dressing for festivals. Friday nights with him all in tails, we'll have dancing. A rip in the bustle and a rustle in the hay and a pitch the quick fantastic with flings of confetti and my petticoats are way up high. It's a very short way from the fling that's for fun to the thigh pressing under the table. It's a very short day till you stop with just one, or it has to be done on the sly. In the meanwhile, there are mouths to be kissed before mouths to be fed, and there's many a tryst and there's many a bet. There's a lot out of mist, but I'll not have been dead when I go. And a person to celebrate everything passing by. And I shall marry the miller's son.
I suppose the oldest question and the most boring question in the world is, which comes first, music or lyrics? Now, you were trained as a musician. You are extremely renowned as a lyricist. So I don't much care at the moment which comes first with you, because it's simultaneously quite obvious. But do you, in fact, ever have a melodic idea first?
It more often happens that in the simultaneous process, what I look for first, I look for two things at the same time. Some kind of title line that sums up what I want to say. And also a rhythmic accompaniment, a musical atmosphere, a vamp of some sort, and from putting the two together, melodic ideas form. I read someplace that Cole Porter, whom I admire inordinately, not inordinately, since he's as good as you can get, that he liked to write lyrics with a specific rhythmic scheme in mind without knowing where the melody was going. It was just one of those things. He would know that that was the rhythm, and then he would find the notes. And I find that very useful, and it's the way I like best to compose, is to hear the rhythm of the melody and then find the notes. Now, of course, there are exceptions. And sometimes you get a melodic idea, as you well know, and sometimes you get an accompanying idea, and sometimes a lyric just starts to build. But generally, I hear the rhythm first.
Let me ask you something. When you first started to write songs where you did both words and music, did you ever consciously say, I'm going to do something different from what has been the norm, or did it just come out?
I started self-consciously being different. Richard Rodgers once made a remark about me saying that Steve writes the kind of tune that goes, dum-de-yum-dum-dum-ding. And indeed, when I first started to write, as in Forum, I deliberately would pick the unexpected note. Mm-hmm. Then you get confident, and you say, it's okay to be what you might consider banal. And then I recognize that what really makes music original is not the unexpected note, but all the things together. The rhythm plus the harmony plus the melody, and each one could be banal in and of itself, but you put them all together, and they spell a lot more than mother. And when I got that confident, then I got more what you would call romantic. The lines flowed more easily. And I like the music better. It sounds more spontaneous, even though it's just as carefully worked over.
What I admire very much is the fact that you kind of take for granted that the people doing your musicals will be very, very good musicians. I mean, I can't imagine somebody way, way out in the provinces doing, you know, 3 days of company. It must be impossible.
It's very hard. Usually, of course, even on Broadway, since you want the play to be a play as well, there comes that dreadful period of compromise where you have to say, all right, the leading man may not be able to sing terribly well, but he's so right for the part, and no other leading man we found is.
Yeah.
And when you do that, you say, well, at least the music's going to be on paper, and somebody else may sing it someday the way it should be sung. I've never really been that disappointed, but certainly there have been compromises with voices all the way through. And as I got more and more interested in writing thicker textures, duets, trios, and contrapuntal choral pieces, it got more and more crucial. The only time I've really had a first-rate singing chorus was in Anyone Can Whistle, because the musical director was particularly hipped on choral singing, and there I had a really first-rate chorus, and it was, unfortunately, the music wasn't quite complex enough to take advantage of it, but it was pretty complex.
Well, the very beginning of night music is difficult.
But I made a stipulation with Hal. I said, if I do this for a quartet or a quintet, I want to be guaranteed that none of them is ever going to have to act in the play, that they are strictly going to be a Greek chorus, and they will be all good singers, because I want a good soprano and a good alto and a good baritone and a good tenor, and a bass if I can get one. We ended up with 3 ladies and 2 men, and they were all first-rate singers, and of course sounded wonderful.
That's great, because usually it's the choreographer who gets that privilege. He says, I want them to dance, I don't care what they look like, sound like, act like, or anything.
Right, but it's a sensible compromise. Today's musical theater requires a good deal more than somebody just singing, somebody just dancing, or somebody just acting. Everybody has to combine all the skills.
Well, and usually the chorus kids in today's musicals dance better than the biggest stars of 30 years ago.
Absolutely. The singing talent is around in America, but people don't write singing shows very much anymore. They write personality shows.
Someone with your reputation, surely you must have a great many opportunities or even seductions into write a big record hit song for, I don't know, Tony Bennett, Ella Fitzgerald. You've never done that.
Do you know, I told you I never have, and you just reminded me I once did for Tony Bennett.
That's unbelievable.
Julie Stein, after we wrote Gypsy, Julie said, look, would you do a song or two for Tony Bennett? He's dying to do some songs. He wants some new songs. Mm-hmm. And I said, all right. That's the only 2 times in my life, those are, when I wrote lyrics that had nothing whatsoever to do with the dramatic structure, apart from the occasional party song for somebody's birthday. And I found it impossible to do for a very simple reason. I don't get ideas for songs. I take all my ideas from the books, from the authors, from the author of the books, from the dialogue, from the characters, from discussing all that. I only write about characters in a play. Mm-hmm. And I would find it very hard, I have found it very hard, to try to just make an idea out of nowhere. I can't say that I couldn't do it, but I find it so difficult and so unsatisfying that I never would. If you said you must write a pop song by tomorrow, I would invent a little one-act play and then write for a character in it.
Oh,
but it's the only way I could do it. It's the only way I could do it is for a character in a situation.
Now, you wrote Gypsy because you wanted to write a vehicle for a star.
Well, Oscar said, you have written now one show for unknowns, meaning West Side. He said you should learn what it is to write for a specific personality. He didn't mean so much star in the sense of glamour as in terms of you have to write songs for Ethel Merman in a dramatic context. How do you make the dog play chess? Well, it turned out, of course, that she was a wonderful actress. Nobody had ever taken advantage of it. But Everything's Coming Up Roses, which I find a very cleverly conceived song, is merely an Ethel Merman 2-4. And the other two people on stage, the daughter and her boyfriend, the mother's boyfriend, react. And it's their reaction that makes it dramatic. And she just comes on singing, Blow, Gabriel, Blow. Well, of course, it turned out that she was so much richer and so much more full of passion than that, that she made the entire scene thrilling because of the emotion she poured into it. But it was a safety song. She could have just sung, Blow, Gabriel, Blow, in essence, and the scene would have been dramatic.
In the many shows you've done since, which tend not to be star vehicles, have you ever written a song or songs specifically for a performer?
Ah, yeah, outside of Ethel, just once. I wrote Send in the Clowns for Glynis. Glynis did not have a song in the second act. This is Glynis Johns, who was the star of A Little Night Music. She did not have a song in the second act, and Hal Prince, the director, felt that she should. We had assumed that the person who played Desiree would not be a singer, that the other people would sing, because we needed a real personality. It turned out that Glynis was very musical. But there was no impulse for her, for the character, to sing in the second act, I felt. There was one big scene between her and the leading man, and I always felt it was the leading man's scene, and I was outlining a song for him, and Hal said, can't you turn it into a song for her? I said, no, the impulse to sing is not Frederick's, it's Desiree's. He said, let me show you the scene. And he directed the scene in such a way that even though on paper it was Frederick's scene, by the time I saw the scene down at rehearsal, it was Desiree's scene. I went home and wrote the song that night because it was so clear from Hal's direction of the and the way they played the scene, that it should be hers. It was designed, I hasten to add, it's my only really big hit song, and it was designed as a little throwaway song for a touching moment for Desiree. Who knew that 2 years later, Frank Sinatra and Judy Collins would discover it and it would become a hit. But it was written specifically for Glynis in that she's very musical, but she cannot sustain long phrases. So it's written in tiny short phrases with plenty of space for her to breathe in between. And for that particular breathy quality that she has as a voice, which I've always described as a rumpled bed, and Send in the Clowns was written for, although Millie Martin does it marvelously in Side by Side by Sondheim.
Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last on the ground, you in midair. Send in the clowns. Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? Keeps tearing around, one who can't move. Where are the clowns? Send in the clowns. Just when I'd stopped opening doors, finally knowing the one that I wanted was yours. Making my entrance again with my usual flair. Sure of my lines, no one is there. Don't you love a farce? My fault, I fear. But where are the clowns? Quick, send in the clowns.
don't bother the heat. Isn't it rich? Isn't it queer? Losing my timing this late in my career. And where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Well, maybe next year.
I tell you what, I wish you would write explicit instructions on a great many songwriters' songs as to how they should be changed and what they should be about and how they should be written and how the words should go and everything else. And thank you very much.
Thanks for having me, Andre.
Thank you.